Good evening. Welcome to the, welcome everybody to the Winnsboro Planning and Zoning Commission meeting. Let the record show that a quorum of commissioners are in attendance. Notice this meeting was posted in accordance with the Texas Open Meetings Act, Chapter 551, and I hereby call this meeting into order at 5:39 p.m. At this time, I would ask everybody in the audience, please silence your cell phones. If you wish to address the board, please wait for the presiding officer to call for comments. Comments from the telephone, well, we don't have telephone audience anymore. So comments from the public will be limited to 3 minutes, and please not interrupt. At this time, I would like to call for any and all public comments. Anyone? No comments? Seeing nobody in the room that wants to comment, I hereby close public comments. We'll move on to consent items. Item number 3, the approval of the minutes from the May 4th, 2021 meeting. Anyone have any modification of the minutes? Anybody have an opportunity to read it?
Yep.
Everything good?
I move we approve the minutes from the prior meeting.
I second.
We got a motion from Cindy, a second from David. All four?
Aye.
Aye. None opposed.
Motion passed.
So we'll go to item number 4, a public hearing for a zoning variance at 913 Beach Street, Lot 11. So, Mr. Linden, would you give us a little rundown of this, please?
Yes, Chairman. We have a request submitted from, let me pull it up here. It's in your packet.
Kenneth
Petit, who owns the property located at the very south end of Beach Street. It's 2.9 acres, and it's the only property in the city that is currently zoned MH, which is mobile homes, and it's been zoned that for since 2003 when the zoning ordinance was adopted. Mr. Poteet is now asking to allow that zoning to include tiny homes. You have a copy of where this is, a map of where this is in your packet. According to Mr. Poteet's plans, the tiny homes in question would appear to be 399 total square foot, one bedroom, one bath, 11 foot 8 inches wide by 34 inches in length, plus a 9 foot outside porch, bringing the overall length to 43 linear feet for the length of the length. Basically, under our definitions of mobile homes, and in accordance with the opinion that was submitted today by our city attorney, which you have a copy of, that that a mobile home, as defined in the Texas Manufacturing Housing Standards, needs a structure that was constructed before June 15th, 1976, transportable in one or more section, which is in the traveling mode, is 8 body feet or more in width or 40 feet more in length, and when erected on site is 320 more or more square feet. It appears that it is at 399, it meets the criteria for overall square footage. When it's built on a permanent chassis designed to be used as a dwelling with or without permanent foundation, when connected to the required utilities, including plumbing, heating, air conditioning, and electrical systems. According to our city attorney, that if it meets this criteria, then it can go in MH, mobile home zone. My only question that I would have, and it's just an informational question, I assume that these will come in on wheels. So that's the only question that I would have. And if that's the case, then it would appear that it would meet the criteria.
the time the ordinance was written, was tiny home even a
No.
Def-
There were no tiny people at that time.
Right. Definition.
These are tiny homes.
So there.
So, okay. It's
Well.
an, it's a, basically a new definition to add to the mobile home kind of target area.
Exactly. And with y'all's, depending on how you go on this, with y'all's recommendation, we can have our attorney add that definition.
Add tiny.
Well, I think that would, you know, most tiny homes are very nice. I just wanna add for clarity.
Hi, Karen.
I just wanna add for clarity.
You're Mr. Potee?
Yes, sir. Sorry.
Go ahead.
I just wanna add for clarity's sake, for anybody watching or listening, because I know it can be really confusing whenever you're reading the 8 feet, or 40 feet in the whole square footage. Just wanna make sure that we're clear that it says it has to either be 8 feet by in width or 40 feet in length, but a total of 320 square feet. No matter how you skin that, it's gotta meet those two criteria. And his model is showing 11 foot 8 inches wide, which is more than the 8 foot wide that is required, but only 34 feet in length. But the total is 399 square feet. So just
so,
so the clarification process is meets the criteria of a manufactured home. So with Mr. Potee here.
Yes, sir.
If you come up here, I think we got some hear from you a little bit on it.
How are you? My name is Kenny Potee. I own Yopper Modeling, the Trailer Park, and I thought I cut this thing off, and 17 other properties, acreages, lands, stuff like that, that I've invested in. Basically, I was assuming, and sometimes we get in trouble when we assume, that a tiny house was a mobile home. Yes, quote, because it took wheels to get there, and when it's set up, you still got to tie it down. It's like a mobile home if it's going to be there any duration of time. The reason I was going with the little tiny homes, I was trying to transfer it all over because it looks so much better. You can put a carport there for the people to sit in, and Winnsboro is going to be big one day, and I want it to be something that looks where it's right across the street from Whispering Pines. I'm hoping to get some people from over there to, you know, they can't live with their spouse to be able to get a place to come there. So I'm making it affordable. And there's a lot of people in Winnsboro, Social Security people, that cannot afford the bigger rents. And I think I offer that little niche in between. I give, my rent is between $600 to $700 a month with washer, dryer, refrigerator, stove. And we mow the grass, we keep the place up, and we try to make it so that it is very clean. When I first took it over, when I first bought it, several years back, there was a large drug problem. I'm just going to put it like that. People migrate to the cheaper housing, and I cleaned all that out. But I encourage Winnsboro police to come down anytime, and I haven't had any problem, but I screen people when they come in. I just tell them point blank, if you use drugs, don't come here, because if I catch you, I'm automatically going to be evicted. But what I was looking for would be just a variance on the park, and then, you know, tell me what y'all think, if it's something that y'all can see in the future, switching everything over to tiny homes or better mobile homes. I want to upgrade the park. It's totally mine. I paid it off. And like I said, I own 17 other properties over in Mount Pleasant. Those are all out of the county, but you still have to go through the sewer programs and all that stuff and get that make sure you're top notch on that. I'm a builder. I've built over 300 homes, but I'm getting to the age where I want to retire. So that's why I went into the rent rental business.
Are you building the homes in the Hollow Mall, or are you purchasing? I mean,
when I first started, I was building them there, and then from that point on, they would be moved. But when I ran into this problem, I stopped everything until you guys said it was okay, because I didn't want to get on the wrong side of y'all. What that would be ideal for me is to say one lot, but I could build them. I've already shipped three off that were there, but it's perfect for a social security person. I've got a lady lives in one that was been there for years already before this, and so I'm just you know, like I said, that I think that's the more practical long term plan would be to make them a little more affordable, but still
aesthetically pleasing.
Yes, and keep that little niche. I mean, I'm getting older, so I identify a little bit more about Social Security. A lot of people don't get very much money on Social Security, but they lived a good life. They went to church all the time. They're good people. They just didn't make a lot of money, and so they're not getting a really big Social Security thing. And Social Security payment. So I, you know, like I said, I have a couple of them, and I have just people that just plain live in the park that work. I got one guy that works all over the world. I've got camera security and everything set up there, so basically he can log into the program and see that his wife's fine, and it ends up being pretty nice for, you know, for the ones that are staying there now. The washer and dryer is really what keeps people, because that saves them 30, 40, 50 bucks a month, you know, from having to go down to the laundry mat.
How many tiny homes can you get in there, in that acreage? How many?
Well, there's room for two more in the back, but it's not plumbed and it's not electric yet. We basically have 13 mobile lots. With the tiny houses, you could feasibly get more, but that's not where I'm going.
Now, sometimes more isn't better. No,
right,
no.
That's not where I'm going right now. What I'm trying to do right now is to, first of all, to get all the lots filled up, and then from that point on, then I can determine, you know, what's what. One of the things about it is that already in the mobile home park, the neighbor doesn't have a lot of room back and forth. So if you cut that down, you're really infringing on their, you know, because it gets too much. So I'm not looking to.
You're not looking for more is better. I understand.
Yeah, I'm not right now. I'm just. I mean, there may come a day. I've got at the very park, back park, as wide as that is, it's 70 feet wide by 20, 30 feet. I mean, there is, you know, down the road possibly, but that would be something I would have to come back in here and get y'all's permission to, you know, let y'all know what I'm doing. That way I would have to get the city to come in, get involved, where we, an architect to get the line, I mean, a surveyor to get the line exactly where we want it and where the sewer is gonna go. Because the way the sewer runs, it would just be just turn and just come this way. But that's not, right now I'm just looking for the variance on the tiny homes when I put them in. And if it's without any kind of problem building them there, I'll keep one lot open to build them. Or if y'all got a problem with that, I can do that somewhere else.
Thank you.
Well, but you're talking about building them on that lot.
Yeah, I've got a lot that used to have a tiny home on it, but it was the bigger tiny home that still had the wheels. In other words, there's two or three different size tiny homes. There's the cabin size, then there's what they call the loft size, where you got two different, you know, different lofts in there. And then there's the one that's got a designated one bathroom, laundry, kitchen, living room, little snack bar area on the left. That's like one of the ones I have over in Mount Pleasant, and that was brought in on mobile home wheels with a mobile home tongue, and they took it off when it was done because it was going to be staying there, and they took the wheels off. Now that would be better if I could put those in there, because They're just a bigger, better, a small, nice looking mobile home is actually what they are, but they look like a house. You know, that's the, you know, the key to it is to make it where it looks good. That's the number one concern for any, you go to these towns and you see these trailer parks and excuse me, but they just trash it. And that, you know, I don't want.
Any more questions?
No?
Is it, I guess I have a question for you. Is it a problem with the city to build them there?
Because word here says transportable.
Are they gonna be built? The way that this is the way the definition reads, and it meets our zoning, current zoning, with if it meets this definition, and that's what we're struggling to get you to, because that would mean that we wouldn't need to do anything. As defined by the Texas Manufacturing Housing Act, HUD code manufactured home means a structure constructed on or after June 15, 1976, according to the rules of the United States Department of Housing and Urban Development, transportable in one or more sections, which in the traveling mode is 8 feet or more in width or 40 feet more in length, or when erected is 320 or more square feet, which is built on a permanent chassis and designed to be used as a dwelling with or without a permanent foundation when connected to the required utilities and includes the plumbing, air conditioning, electrical system. The term does not include a recreational vehicle. The thing that I'm concerned about here is that it says, and which is built on a permanent chassis.
Mm-hmm.
Will they be built on?
Yeah, and excuse me, I need to clarify that. When I say build them, so that there's no misunderstanding, what I do is I buy, I don't know if I included it in my file, but basically what I do is I get the building already made on the outside, the chassis, everything's ready to go, and what I do is just finish it out. Does that make more sense?
Okay. I was thinking since you were a builder,
yeah,
that you were constructing it from scratch.
I tried that.
You trim them out, you finish it out.
Yes, sir. I tried that, but it really got to the point that it wasn't cost feasible.
Right.
Especially now, the wood has actually doubled since February to right now. The wood has doubled, and you know, so when I say build, it will come to the site
on a chassis.
Yeah, on a chassis, ready to go, approved
with
the and the state's got a state, the people that I'm buying from. My daughter runs that Jones building up here in Sulphur Springs,
mm-hmm.
right across from Walmart. Those buildings, that's where I get the majority of my buildings from.
Okay.
You know, is what I'll do is I'll go in there and get the building, and I use spray foam instead of regular insulation, because that spray foam is tremendous for keeping it very, very cool inside. So I spray foam it, then I turn around and come in and we'll put the paneling and the different different type interiors with
that
it.
Clears up our questions.
Yeah. You know,
the only other question that's left hanging out there is that it has to be built according to the rules of HUD. Okay. Do you know if you're finishing out in accordance with the rules for HUD's manufacturing?
Yes. It's the same way when I build a house. I've got to follow the guidelines out by the principality that I live in.
Yeah.
So when the house, whether the wiring or the plumbing is a certified electrician, certified plumber, the only thing that the wooden, you know, their carpenter work and all that kind of stuff,
it's still considered a dwelling, so you got to meet all city codes.
Yeah, got to meet, there's nothing that prevents it, and we'll have to pull a permit when it's time to hook it up to the grid. But the key to it, and this is, I'm insured for a little over $1 million on the liability, but I don't want any problems where I sell that and somebody comes back and said it was a bad wiring job, or somebody says, hey, I've got problems with my plumbing. You do not want to have problems with your plumbing. You want to have one outtake where the sewer's hooked up to, you want to have one outtake where your water's hooked up to, and you want to have your box where your electricity comes in, just like a mobile home, nothing different. Everything set up the same way.
And all this being done by licensed electricians.
Yes, sir. And I still have to go through the pulling permit, and the electrician will come out there and hook it up and everything, and then make sure all the inspections, and then the city inspector comes out.
Wayne comes out.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So we're good on all that. And that's not, even if y'all didn't make me do that, that's something that I was taught from a very young age, just to do it right. You know, to get your, because people invest a lot of money in these things. You know, right now they're going $70 a square foot, and that's before the lumber increase. And so, and there's a lot of people going to these, you know, and I have some of them that I could actually put on trailers if I had to, I could put them on the trailer, but that's defeating my purpose, you know, of making sure the mobile home park is still functioning, because when the mobile home park is filled, first of all, it means 13 water bills, 13 electricity bills, 13 garbage pickup. You know, it means different for the city, but it also means is that'll leave me free to where I could still have one brought in down at the area that's open and do the work down there. And right now, I have no plans to bring any more in. I can let y'all know when I'm getting ready to have one delivered, or you know, if you guys need to know that, that's no problem. But the ones that I've got to finish up what I got in there now.
Yeah.
You know, because when this first started, they said hold up until we find out. So I've done nothing since then. So this will. Whichever answer I get today, this will bring us to a close on that part.
Well, according to the information that he's given, we don't really take any action because it meets the current criteria for the zoning.
Yeah.
That's what I was going to ask you. So as long as he's building on a chassis versus a slab or a pier and beam, then it already meets the criteria.
There's no variance needed.
The only thing that would make sure that we couldn't fall out of is the parameters on the square foot. You know, the minimum of 320 square foot, you know, as defined here. But
well, we don't build. We build the smaller ones. That you could get the tiny home up, but then it.
So what's the smallest one you plan on putting out there?
It would be a 12 by 30,
okay.
32. You know, and but here's the thing, so that we make sure we understand, there is no pier and beam, and there won't be a concrete, because then that becomes a permanent structure, and I feel like to put a permanent structure down there, I need to come talk to y'all again about that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, does that make sense?
Yes, that would
change. As long as we can pick it up and move it, I think we're good, but if we get to the point where we're saying okay, and then that, it doesn't become a mobile home park anymore; it becomes a residential area, so that defeats the whole zoning of the property.
I think you've answered all.
You've answered it.
Yeah, we don't need anything, Mr. Poteet. We do appreciate your investment in Winnsboro.
Thank you very much.
You're good to go, man.
I appreciate it, guys.
Thank
now, will
you.
I hear anything? I'm good to go.
No, you're good.
At this point, you're good to go.
Okay. So I can get my electricians out there and start everything over again. Okay. I
thank
appreciate
you
that. Thank you
all. Clarifying all this.
Thank you. Okay. Yeah, I'll get the electrician. Normally, I was just going down there, but we'll get it worked out.
So
right
we'll
time.
Thank
you
all.
Right.
Thank you.
In light of all the information given, there is no action to be taken.
No, but I still need you to do a public hearing because I need you to call it open and close with times because we did in fact have a report, even though there's nobody here.
All right. Public hearing will now be given is at 6:03. Anybody? Bueller? Public hearing is now closed at 6:03.
I'm not only coming back in to take y'all again, but again.
Thank you, man.
discussion only, up for consideration is the sign ordinance and the historic district. Here we go.
Okay, let me just give you an update on the historic district ordinance where we left off a few months ago. We left the historic district ordinance, the vacant building ordinance, in the hands of the city attorney to do a final review after the last weeks that the Planning and Zoning Commission made. He's informed me, and actually I have a appointment with him tomorrow at 1 o'clock. I'll bring it up at that time too, but he has informed me that they have done their final revisions of it, and in his opinion, it's good to go back to this commission to be sent to city council for consideration. I would like to, if it's okay with y'all, give you a copy of the final, because it's been a while since we've looked at it, give you a copy of the copy that he has and that he has put his approval to, and allow for you to do any last minute wordsmithing or anything, and then bring it back either at a workshop or definitely at the meeting in July to make a formal motion to send it to city council for consideration, if you feel that is appropriate.
I love that, yes.
That's great.
That works a little bit.
Okay. With regard to the sign ordinance, what I suggest that we do is that we adopt it. When was it that we did that? Was it this year or last year?
This year.
The original, the one that's on there now?
Yeah, well, the one that we did for downtown.
Oh, that was last year.
Really? You think it was last year?
I think it was, because.
No, we did one that was citywide.
I thought we did one.
No, we didn't.
I might not have been.
Not, yeah, not.
Okay.
While you were gone.
While I was gone, so I don't know.
What we did was we did billboards citywide.
Yes.
Right.
We had billboards, that was in January.
That was this year, yes.
That was in January, February of this year.
Yes.
We haven't done a citywide sign ordinance.
Right.
Yes. Councilmember Morris raised a question at, when we approved billboard ordinance, about a citywide sign ordinance. What I would suggest that we do is I give you all a copy of the most current sign ordinance, including the amendment to it that addresses citywide billboards, and that you all do some wordsmithing to the downtown sign ordinance and see if what's appropriate and what's not appropriate citywide. And we can definitely have a workshop on that for discussion purposes. We can have it sometime this month if you would like, give you a couple of weeks to look at it. And then we can go from there and try to get something on the July meeting for a draft on that. If that's okay with y'all.
But we're not going to change the billboard part of it, right? You're just going to include that for us to look at?
Okay. I'm just going to include that for y'all to look at.
Can we go ahead and set a date for another workshop before the July meeting?
Because
if we can get
things,
because we need
wrapped up in, so that on July we're ready to move forward.
That's a good idea, John.
And we might have to do it all in order between now and then. That's why I'm wanting to do it soon.
As far as I'm concerned, it's tough. I'm coaching my kid all-star baseball team, so it's really tough. I'll have the schedule tomorrow of what his tournaments look like. So it's hard for me to answer that right now. I want to do it, but I'm going to have to get his schedule before I can tell you what I can do.
Do you know what day is going
in? I know it's Thursday, Friday, he's been practicing. I know he's got a tournament the 11th through the 13th. But anything other than that, I won't know until tomorrow.
Okay.
So, I mean, we could do...
we need to do something. That's the same thing that what happened last time.
Yeah, I don't want
to
hold us up. So,
John, can you commit to letting everybody know by tomorrow after you get the schedule?
Well, or if you care to know that he's 11 through 13, you're busy. What about the 14th, which is a Monday?
It's June. Are you talking June?
That's why I
did it before July.
Oh, I'm out. It's flagging.
Yeah, I'm out. That's flagging. I'm out. All the
2 weeks to review?
That'll work.
Yeah.
When do you wanna do it? I'm off all day, when does it work?
He's the only one that's working.
I'm calling you guys pressure on me to that.
All I need, John.
Well, I mean, we're flexible, so.
Yeah, wanna do lunch, do pizza and cookies?
I like that idea.
That's just me.
Who's making the pizza?
Listen, if we can do a date, well.
You wanna do a play date?
How about the 14th?
What time?
4:30.
Okay.
Is that early enough?
Yeah, no, yeah, anytime, we're not working, remember, we're all retired, except for the guy on the other side of you.
Yes.
Well, he just cuts hair.
I just cut hair.
And he cuts Craig's hair, I mean, my goodness, what's that?
Doesn't take long.
And yours, keep it up, you guys.
Monday the 14th at 4:30?
Yeah, and there are some changes.
Worst case scenario, I might be a little late, but y'all just roll without me.
So do you want just sign ordinance on that workshop agenda, or do you want?
And a historic.
Okay, review both of them.
Review both.
You got that, Madam Secretary? Madam, hey, Madam.
I'd like to discuss historic, but we'll probably spend a lot of time on sign.
Good.
Historic shouldn't take too long.
Shouldn't take too long. And I'll get you guys copies of those tomorrow before close of business.
Ooh, that's specific. That's a commitment.
That was more like a cable guy commitment, though, it was like 8 to 5, can you get it?
Yeah, that really was.
Well, how about this?
Between here and here, right.
I will call you 2 hours either way.
There you go.
All right.
Sounds like the cable guy.
Anything else, commissioners?
Nope.
All right. Well, then, our next regular, well, hold on, let me close that item number 6, we're done with it at 6:11. I'm supposed to do that, Angie, that was for you.
You're good.
Stop.
So, our next regularly scheduled P&Z meeting, will be July the 6th at 5:30. And I thank everybody out here for joining us.
Thank you.
Your input was fantastic. And I expect to see at least this many out here at the next meeting. And we are adjourned at 6:12.
All right. Way to go, John.
Yes.
My microphone's been working too.
Mine never did work.
Hey, let me push him up, brother.
John's still working.
My free chair, bro.
Mine never did.
Yeah, where you at?